Now what we're looking at here is a peripheral motor neuron. So we see the cell body and the long axon projecting from it. We know this is the axon, it's carrying the nerve fibres, the nerve impulses away along the long thin nerve fibre. Carrying the nerve impulses away from the cell body. That is what axons do. And here we have some other fibres, and these are carrying nerve impulses towards the cell body. And if a nerve impulse is being carried in a fibre towards the cell body, that nerve fibre is a dendrite. Here we see the cell body with the nucleus. And surrounding the axon here, we can clearly see the myelin sheath. Now the myelin sheath in the peripheral nervous system is made up of Schwann cells. It's one of the relatively rare cases in anatomy and histology where we use the names of the original discoverer. For example, these nodes between the Schwann cells used to be called the nodes of Ranvier, but now we call them the neurofibril nodes. But the Schwann cells make up the fatty myelin sheath, which insulates, protects and nourishes the nerve fibre. And it also facilitates rapid neuronal transmission. So the nerve impulse can like bounce from one node of Ranvier or one neurofibril node to the next in the process called saltatory transmission. And this greatly increases the speed at which the nerve impulse can travel really quickly, even 100 metres per second or even more in some myelinated fibres, very rapid rate of transmission. And because it's a motor neuron, it's going to bring about some sort of movement. So the end part of the motor neuron is going to innervate. Very often it's going to be a muscle. So the nerve impulse is going to come down the motor neuron. The electrical nerve impulse is going to go into the muscle, causing the muscle to contract, bringing about a motor activity. And typically in the peripheral nervous system, the cell body of the motor neuron here is going to be in the spinal cord, with the axon leaving via a spinal nerve to supply a particular segment, or in this case a particular area of muscle, with neuronal innervation. Now in the motor neuron we've just looked at, the new nerve impulse was generated in the cell body. But with a sensory neuron, it's different. With a sensory neuron, there's a peripheral sensory receptor, as it says, in the periphery. It could be in the skin, for example. So there's a peripheral sensory receptor. And when that peripheral sensory receptor is stimulated by an external stimulus, it will generate a brand new nerve impulse. Brand new nerve impulse as a result of peripheral sensory stimulation. And that nerve impulse will go from the peripheral sensory receptor along this long fibre here towards the spinal cord. This is in the lower part of the body. Now we can see here that the impulse is being carried towards the cell body, because this is the cell body here. And in the case of the sensory neuron, the cell body is near the spinal cord. That means this fibre carrying the impulse towards the cell body is a dendrite. So motor neurons typically have short dendrites and long axons, whereas sensory neurons have long dendrites and often short axons. So that's the axon there. And we know that's the axon because that's carrying the nerve impulse away from the cell body. In this case, into the spinal cord. And we see that this is a myelinated nerve fibre again, with the Schwann cells. Nerve cells in the central nervous system also have myelin sheaths. But in that case, the myelin is made from cells called oligodendrocytes, whereas in the peripheral nervous system, it's the Schwann cells. But again, there's rapid bouncing saltatory transmission. taking this nerve impulse very quickly from the periphery into the spinal cord. And from the spinal cord, this will connect with other neurons which will ascend, taking the impulse and the information that impulse is conveying up to the brain. Now, the nerve fibres we've been looking at so far, the axons and the dendrites, are at a cellular level. Therefore, they are microscopic. And many nerve fibres, here's individual nerve fibres, perhaps individual axons, are grouped together with surrounding connective tissue in a structure called a nerve. And these will form a macroscopic structure. So the nerve fibres are microscopic, the nerves are macroscopic. Some large nerves can carry several tens of thousands of individual nerve fibres. And very often the nerves have a whitish appearance in the body because of the fatty nature of the connective tissue, providing electrical insulation and protection for the individual nerve fibres within the macroscopic nerve. Now here we see the relation of the sensory neuron and the motor neuron to the spinal cord. So here's the peripheral sensory receptor. Here's the dendrite of the sensory neuron, the cell body, and the axon is going into the spinal cord. And here we have a transverse section of the spinal cord. And we notice that all of the sensory fibres are going in via the back of the spinal cord. That's the front. So all of the sensory impulses go in the back. And the motor neuron cell bodies are here in the front. So all of the motor impulses go out the front. So here's the axon of the motor neuron, in this case again going to a skeletal muscle. So it's always in the back via the dorsal root, the posterior root, and out the front via the ventral or the anterior root of the spinal cord. And what we can actually see here is this is the spinal nerve, where both sensory and motor fibres travel together before dividing as they get near the spinal cord, so the sensory can go in the back and out the front. Now, if I touch something hot or sharp, it's a good idea to pull my hand away quickly before my tissues become damaged. And this is facilitated by what we call a spinal level reflex arc. So here we have the peripheral sensory receptor and the dendrite of the sensory neuron, the cell body of the sensory neuron, and the axon of the sensory neuron going into the spinal cord. And yes, when this gets into the spinal cord, it will synapse with other neurons which take that information up to the brain. But if we were touching something sharp and our tissues were being damaged, we don't want to have to wait for the impulse to go up to the brain to think, oh, that hurts, pull it away, the motor impulse to go down to finally pull it away from whatever's injuring your tissues. You want it to happen quickly. And that's what a reflex arc does. It does this quickly. So the sensory neuron goes in here and it connects with a little neuron here called a relay neuron, which carries the information across the spinal cord directly to the motor neuron. So here's the cell body of the motor neuron. The impulse will go along the axon of the motor neuron, quickly innervating the muscle, pulling your hand away from whatever's causing it. The clever bit is, of course, that it pulls away the right muscle. So Something damaging the tissue is detected. Impulse goes very quickly across there, and out there really quickly, bringing the hand away. And in fact, you can actually pull your hand away before the brain realises that it's being injured. And this makes it much faster. So the brain is informed, but reflexes will work on spinal cord level, and there's an arc, goes around there really quickly like that, to protect the body against damage. Blinking is another type of reflex. If something flickers your eyes tend to shut really quickly to try and protect your eyes from possible damage. But this one's at spinal cord level. The three components, the three neuronal components, the sensory relay and motor neuron, comprising a reflex arc. And it looks like kind of an arc shape, doesn't it? I guess that's why it's called a reflex arc. Now here we see two vertebrae. These are the spinous processes. So when you feel someone's back, you can feel those knobbly bits. And inside we have these thicker bodies of the vertebrae. And between them we have the intervertebral discs. And if we look at one vertebrae, we can see that there's a spinal canal down the middle, and that is where the spinal cord runs up and down through the vertebrae. And if we relate this to the larger model of the vertebral column, here we can see the bodies of the vertebrae at the front. Here we can see the spinal nerve sticking out, and at this level the spinal nerves will contain motor and sensory fibres. And we can see there's 31 pairs of spinal nerves. Well, you can only see some of them on this shot, but there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And we can see the spinal cord running inside. So here we see the body of the vertebrae, the processes, and the spinal canal. So the spinal cord runs through this gap in the vertebrae up and down, where it's nicely protected by the bony structures of the vertebrae. So here we're looking at a cross section of the spinal cord again. This is the back and this is the front. And we notice that in the cross section of the spinal cord, running up and down through the length of the spinal cord, just like the words Blackpool Rock, run up and down through the middle of a stick of Blackpool Rock, we have an eight-shaped area of grey matter. Now, when anatomists first started cutting spinal cords, they'd make a section of the spinal cord and they would notice that there's grey matter on the inside and white matter on the outside. Of course, they were looking at dead spinal cords in life. This is actually more a pinky matter because it's perfused with blood. But we're stuck with the names grey matter, white matter. Now what happens is, here's the spinal nerves on either side. Let's just look at one side. Here's the spinal nerve, as we've just seen in yellow in the previous model. And when it gets near the spinal cord, this is going to divide into a posterior nerve root going in the back. And here we have an area called the dorsal root ganglia. And the reason it's called the dorsal root ganglia is a ganglia is a collection of nerve cell bodies, because the nerve cell bodies are situated just there in the dorsal root ganglia before the axon carries on in to the spinal cord. The motor cell neurons are in the ventral horns or the anterior horns, and they will leave via this front anterior ventral root to go out into the body in the spinal nerve. So we've got grey matter in the dorsal horns where the impulses are coming in. We've got grey matter in the ventral or the anterior horns where we have the cell bodies for the motor neurons leaving the spinal cord. The impulses going in are called afferent impulses. So this is an afferent neuron here. The sensory neuron is afferent, carrying information in towards the spinal cord, which is of course part of the central nervous system. And the fibres carrying impulses out are called efferents. So it's E for efferent. Afferent going in, efferent for exit going out. So sensory neurons are afferents, motor neurons are efferents. Now, nerve impulses are electrical in nature, and the electrical current is generated across the nerve fibre and nerve cell body external membranes. So here we have a cell, and we notice that this cell is polarised. What that means is it's electrically negative inside and positive outside. And this electrical potential difference is maintained by pumping out positive ions such as sodium. And when a cell is polarised, it's negative inside, positive outside, to the tune of round about 70 millivolts. 70 millivolts. So it's 70 millivolts negative on the inside compared to the positive outside. Now, a millivolt is a thousandth of a volt. So this is like just under a tenth of a volt, isn't it? But it's actually a voltage. It's an electrical potential difference. Now, when a nerve impulse is actually passing, there's going to be a redistribution of ions across the membrane. For example, sodium ions are going to come in. And I think if you can see a lot of positive ions are going in, it's going to become positive inside and negative outside. So it changes from being polarised via the process of depolarisation to being a depolarised cell. And it will probably be something like plus 30 millivolts inside there at the peak of the depolarisation. Now, if a nerve impulse is a process of depolarisation, it follows that once a nerve impulse has passed, if this cell is going to depolarise again, the depolarized cell must repolarize first. So when a nerve impulse has passed, the depolarized component will repolarize so it's ready for the next nerve impulse. And we can see this on this lower diagram. Here it's negative, this is the resting potential, and here we have the action potential. The bit where the action potential is not yet reached is still polarized at the resting potential. So the action potential here is a depolarized area. And it passes along the fiber in a wave. So a split second later, we look at the same length of nerve fiber and we see that the wave of depolarization has passed on. It's now a little bit further up. A split second later, we see it's a little bit further up again. So the wave of depolarization is moving electrically along the nerve fiber. This is what a nerve impulse actually is. It's an electrical wave of depolarization. And we call it the action potential. It's the actual nerve impulse. Now, we've seen that when a nerve impulse is travelling down a nerve fibre, it's electrical in nature. So here we have an axon of a presynaptic neuron. Now, the synapse is actually this physical gap between two neurons. So any two nerve fibres don't touch, there's a physical gap. And the reason for this is we want the nerve impulses to be able to go from the presynaptic side to the postsynaptic side. But if an impulse does arise and comes the wrong way up a postsynaptic neuron, we don't want that impulse to be able to get from that side to that side. So we do want it to go from the presynaptic to the post, but not from the post to the presynaptic side. And we see that in the end of the presynaptic neuron and this synaptic end bulb, there's some mitochondria, which are good because it supplies energy. There's the mitochondria. But what we see is there's lots of vesicles here containing chemical transmitter substances. What this chemical transmitter substance is will vary. In the peripheral nervous system, it's often acetylcholine or noradrenaline. In the central nervous system, it could be many things such as serotonin, which is 5-hydroxytryptamine, or GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid, or various other chemical transmitters. Dopamine is a common transmitter in the central nervous system. But when a nerve impulse arrives in the presynaptic neuron, whether it's in the central nervous system or the peripheral nervous system, the electrical impulse arriving here causes some of these chemical transmitters to be released into the synaptic gap. Because the synaptic gap is very narrow, these will diffuse across quickly. When chemical transmitter arrives at specific receptor molecules, specific receptor sites on the postsynaptic membrane, when enough of the chemical transmitter activates enough of the receptors on the postsynaptic membrane, that will cause the postsynaptic membrane to depolarize, generating a new nerve impulse, which will then carry on traveling down in the postsynaptic neuron. This is a valve. It ensures one-way flow. It can go from there to there, but not from there to there. Should an ectopic impulse arise and tries to go the wrong way, it can't get from there to there because there's no chemical transmitter here and there's no receptor molecules here. So it can only go from the presynaptic to the postsynaptic, ensuring one-way flow around about the nervous system. What we're looking at here is the synaptic gap under greater magnification. So this is the presynaptic membrane here, the end of the presynaptic neuron, and this is the postsynaptic membrane here on the other side of the synaptic gap. And when a nerve impulse arrives, that's going to stimulate some of this chemical transmitter to be released into the synaptic gap, where it's going to diffuse across the synapse. As we see here, there are specific receptor sites waiting for the arrival of the chemical transmitter, and the chemical transmitter fits into the specific receptor site, into the receptor molecule. When enough chemical transmitter gets into enough receptor sites, that will generate a new nerve impulse in the postsynaptic neuron. So the nerve impulse goes from being electrical to being chemical to being electrical once more. So here we see the axon of a motor neuron, surrounded by its myelin sheath, made up of Schwann cells. And here we can see we have a muscle, a skeletal muscle. Now, if an electrical impulse is generated in the skeletal muscle, we don't want that to go from the muscle back into the nervous system, because we don't want nerve impulses travelling the wrong way in motor neurons. We want them travelling from the central nervous system to the periphery. We don't want the nerve impulses going back the way. So we have a synaptic gap in the muscle. Here's the synaptic end bulb of the motor neuron. And we notice that there's a physical gap. And the receptor sites are in this structure here, embedded in the muscle, called the motor end plate. So in this case, we see that the chemical transmitter is acetylcholine. A nerve impulse coming down the motor neuron will cause acetylcholine to be released from the synaptic end bulb. That acetylcholine will fit into acetylcholine receptor molecules in the motor end plate. The combination of the acetylcholine and the receptor molecule will cause depolarization in the muscle. And when muscles depolarize, they contract. So actually, nerves and muscles are both electrical in the way they work. They're described as excitable cells because they can both generate electrical potential differences across their cell membranes. In the case of the nerve, it generates a wave of depolarization carrying an electrical nerve impulse. In the case of the muscle, the depolarization causes muscular contraction and therefore movement. Now, if we take the brain out of the skull, as we can do in this model, take the top of the skull off, the top of the cranial bones, we can take the brain out. Oh, here we have the brain, which is good. Here we see the skull that the brain's come out of. And we notice that the brain is in three main areas. This large top part is called the cerebrum. And we also notice that the cerebrum is in two cerebral hemispheres. Part of this has been coloured on this side. To the back, we notice that there is this brown structure. And this is called the cerebellum. So we have the cerebrum and the cerebellum. And then the third component of the brain is the brain stem. This bit in here is the brain stem. So we have the cerebrum, cerebellum, and brain stem. And the cerebrum is divided into different lobes, which have been nicely coloured on this model. So here we have the frontal lobes in orange, the parietal lobes in blue, the temporal lobes in yellow, and the occipital lobe at the back in green. Underneath, just on the as in the previous model, we have the cerebellum. And in this one, the brain stem is two different colours, but this is all the brain stem. What's this little bit here sticking out the bottom? What's that little bit? Well, that's actually the pituitary gland at the base of the brain. So the three areas of the brain and the lobes of the cerebrum. So on this diagram, we see the cerebrum, the large top part of the brain. This is the cerebrum. We see the cerebellum, which is this part. And we see the brain stem just here. And the brain stem is continuous with the spinal cord. We notice the frontal lobes, the parietal lobes. Actually, we can only see one here, can't we? So it's the frontal lobe, the parietal lobe. But we do know there are two, because there's one on the other side as well. The temporal lobe above the ears. And at the back we have the occipital lobe. So looking from the top, we can see the two hemispheres of the cerebrum, the two cerebral hemispheres. This is the right, this is the left, this is the front. So we see the frontal lobes. Right frontal lobe, left frontal lobe, parietal lobe. We can't see the temple, that's underneath. And occipital lobe here at the back. So the cerebral cortex, looking at it from above, showing the two cerebral hemispheres. Here we see the brain looking at the left side, because this is the front and this is the back. And we notice that there are particular areas of the brain with particular responsibilities. Now this area here is called the central sulcus. Anything in front of the central sulcus here is frontal lobe. Behind the central sulcus, this area here is going to be parietal lobe. And we notice that there are particular functions associated with particular areas. So the motor cortex, this left motor cortex, is going to generate movement of the right hand side of the body. And this left sensory cortex is going to provide sensation for the right hand side of the body, because it's the opposite way around. This is the left side, so it's looking after the right side of the body. This bit here is looking after the eye movements. This area here is generating speech. This is sometimes called Broca's area. And in most people, this is just on the left hand side. These other areas are on the right and the left cerebral hemispheres, but the speech centres are usually just on the left. Now, there's another area for speech at the back for understanding speech, and this is sometimes called Wernicke's area. So Broca's area is for the generation of speech. Wernicke's area is for understanding speech. Here we have an auditory area for hearing. And at the back here we have the visual areas where you see. So the image you're now looking at is actually being generated in the back, in the occipital lobe of the brain. So particular functions associated with particular areas of the cerebral cortex. So here we see the brain in section, down the middle, looking at the cerebellum, the brain stem, which as we see is continuous with the spinal cord, the cerebrum on the top. Now it's essential that one cerebral hemisphere can communicate with the other cerebral hemisphere. So going in and out the plane of this picture, joining the two cerebral hemispheres together, are a large bundle of connecting nerve fibres called the corpus callosum. This is the brain stem here, and between the brain stem and the cerebrum is another area of the brain called the diencephalon. So slightly more complicated model: cerebrum, diencephalon, corpus callosum, brainstem, spinal cord, cerebellum. Now here we see a cross-section of the cerebral cortex. The cortex is the outer part of an organ. So this is the cerebral cortex we're looking at here. And this is the lower part of the brain here. And we see this is arranged in a series of waves. The upper parts are called a gyrus. The lower parts are called a sulcus. So we go down a sulcus, up a gyrus. Down a sulcus, up a gyrus. So the cortex is arranged in sulci and gyri. The brain has grey matter on the outside, white matter on the inside. It's the converse of the spinal cord, because remember, the spinal cord was grey on the inside and white on the outside. And looking down at this lower diagram, we see why this is. If we assume that this is an area of the motor cortex, we see that there's lots of individual nerve cell bodies in the motor cortex, and they have fibres projecting down, taking the motor impulses through the brain, down to the spinal cord, and onto the body. These are white because they have fatty myelin sheaths around them. So the grey matter on the outside is rich in nerve cell bodies. The white matter on the inside is carrying the nerve fibres surrounded by their fatty myelin sheaths. Now this diagram shows a little more detail on the brain stem. So this is the brain stem round about here. We see the cerebellum at the back. And we know that the brain stem is continuous with the spinal cord. But here we see the brain stem is in three sections. The top part of the brain stem is called the midbrain. The middle part of the brain stem is called the pons, which is Latin for bridge. And the lower part of the brain stem, containing many of the autonomic centres of the body, governing such things as blood pressure, cardiac activity, respiratory activity. The lower part of the brain stem, continuous with the spinal cord, is the medulla oblongata. Now it's very important that the nervous system is protected from damage. So here we see how this is done in the area of the skull, although it's actually the same all the way down the spinal cord, because these layers that protect the brain go around the brain and they go down the spinal cord. But here we see the hair and the skin on the outside. And here in the middle we see the brain. If you're fortunate, you have hair here on the outside. This layer here is the bone of the skull, the thick bone of the skull, relatively thick, protecting the contents of the cranial cavity underneath. Then immediately under the bone of the skull is a thick layer of tough fibrous tissue there called the dura mater. Underneath the dura we have another layer, a spidery layer, a web-like layer called the arachnoid mater. And projections from the arachnoid mater go down here. And these projections of the arachnoid mater go down onto the surface of the brain, which is surrounded by another layer called the pia mater. So we've got the dura mater, arachnoid mater, pia mater. These are the three layers of the meninges. So the meninges are the dura, arachnoid, pia. Sometimes it's said that the meninges pad the brain. Pia, arachnoid, dura, in that order. And very importantly, below the arachnoid mater, above the pia mater, in this area here called the subarachnoid space, we have cerebrospinal fluid, about 150 mils altogether in an adult. Cerebro because it goes around the brain, spinal because it goes around the spinal cord. So the whole central nervous system is essentially floating in this layer of cerebrospinal fluid, acting as a shock absorber for the central nervous system. So the delicate neurological tissues of the brain, protected by the skin, bone, dura, arachnoid mater, cerebrospinal fluid, pia mater, and only then do you get down to the brain itself.